So, welcome back for yet another video. Today we got this beautiful mainboard in front of us in a white design. This is a Z170A. It's an X-Power Gaming Titanium Edition. This is 6th and 7th gen, if I'm not mistaken. Intel-based platform with DDR4 already. This is quite an enthusiast board. This has overclocking special, this has test points, this has inbuilt postcodes, this has dedicated buttons, has quite a lot of PCIe, has additional PCIe power, has quite a beefy VRM, I would guess, quite good I.O. Yeah, this thing came to me for no post from a friend of mine. I quite quickly realized that the first two RAM slots were dead. He didn't bother to check switching the DIMMs, so I just connected a single DIMM in every single slot, and I realized those two DIMMs are working. They are working fine. The board booted up normally with them, and the first two ones always hung up on code 35 and 55. That is RAM not detected. It was showing up on the inbuilt one that is down here, and on the one that I always plug in additionally. So first thing that I done to actually test this thing, because I knew the first two RAM slots were broken, because I did some other tests, like I tested the NVMe and I ran some stress tests and different stuff with the CPU in with the third and fourth slot, and everything was working perfectly. So all we had was those two DIMM slots not working. So what we did, we used this cheap Chinese DDR4 tester that probably most of you have seen before. It's written down here. DDR4, that's the tester. This one is going to test all the data lines on the slots as soon as the CPU is plugged in. And there are LEDs, rows of LEDs. And the ones that aren't connected will not light up. So all the ones that are connected will light up. I'm quickly going to install this into the mainboard, just like a CPU. You always need a CPU installed to try this. So I'm quickly going to pause the video, install a CPU, install this one, and I'm going to show you how it looks. So right now we have our CPU. This is an i3-6100, our test CPU, known good, plugged in. And we have our RAM tester. So we're now going to flip the switch. And as you can see, most of these LEDs are on. But not all of them. There's some in the middle that aren't on, and the ones marked in black. These are some redundant ones for ECC memory, and there's also different LEDs that are supposed to light up for AM4. So if the ones in the middle aren't lit up for at least this generation on this board, that's okay. And the ones that are marked in black, with Sharpie in this case, are also not supposed to light up. And as you can see, all of these are lighting up. Even if you wiggle those, it's not going to change. But what we had at the beginning, where the second last and the third last LED of this bottom row not lighting up. Those I'm going to switch probably to the microscope and show you those. 1 second. Now we can see our tester close up. As you can see, the one marked with Sharpie in black is not currently on. And the ones that weren't on are DQS7P and DQ57. Those two were not lit when I got this mainboard in the first and in the second slot. So the next thing to look at was obviously our CPU slot, because if you didn't know, the connections between the CPU and the RAM are most of the time just copper tracks directly going all the way to the right, as you can see here. These tracks are just paint, These aren't the actual tracks. The actual tracks I'm going to show you later, as you can see down there. But these tracks actually run this way all the way directly to the RAM slots. So, thing was, I directly checked our slot for or the CPU socket, and the socket looks immaculate. Like, as you can see, they all look perfect. So, next thing was, you can actually search by the missing diodes or the missing LEDs on the DDR tester. You could actually see which of these pins correspond to the signal that is missing on the DDR tester. For that, we're going to go over to our board view. So I have the schematic for this particular board. And the pins that are interesting for us are going to be AJ2, AJ1, and AK3, MData 56. Those are correspondent to the signals that were missing on our DDR tester. As you can see, one of the pins goes to the right of these two. Then we have the two other pins that are going here, and one more pin that is this one that goes there. So what we had to do, as you can see, this luckily is a CAD model of the board view. So there's actually outlines of the traces where they go, or very roughly outlines of the traces where they go. So first thing I did was to go into the continuity mode and check if there's connections between these points and the points in the RAM slots, because I do not know how these points correspond to the points and at the top of the RAM slot. I just soldered wires to those points on the back side, because on the back side they are all visible and they are all easy to see. So that's how I did it, and I found out that the connection is broken on these three pins. These three pins are broken to the RAM slot. So, first order of magnitude now was to find out where those traces run. And because we only have this CAD file to go off of, I had to do quite some digging. As you can see here, I removed quite of the mask. This is guesswork. I did not know where the traces ran. So I just took the Dremel out and Dremeled away the PCB mask. And I was actually able to find which traces go where. So all I did was continue to mode again. Put one probe onto the pins, one probe onto these lines. And I found out these two lines are the two pins that were above each other. So I think it's from the seventh row. From this row, the second and the third are these two signals. I saw that the break is not in the slot because I had continuity all the way to here. And as if you can remember correctly, we had yet another one that was broken, yet another trace, which is right there. I didn't clean up after soldering. Let's see if this cleans up here. Really does not want to clean up. But like this, you can see it better. This is where the break of one of the traces was. So the trace runs there and there. And here I took off the masking of the board. You can see I also took the masking off here for the other traces. But here parallel to those two is another trace. And as you can see, the PCB was damaged in this place. And that made it quite a lot easier for me to look at this area and instantly see that this was the break. The break was actually so small that I could even just bridge it with solder. So this already restored one of the LEDs on our tester. I don't quite remember which of the LEDs it was, but this was the first fix. This was the easy one. This went quite quick. The other one, which is quite a lot harder to find, because on the other one, I never found the actual breakpoint. So it was those two lines, these two lines, I followed all the way to the RAM slot. Because I couldn't find where they broke. So I continued, as you can see, took away mask there, took away mask there, even took away mask down there to see where the break is, but I couldn't find the break on this way. So I had continuity from these points up to the slot, but I didn't have continuity into the RAM banks. So what I did, I took enameled wire, as you can see here, soldered them on, got some solder mask onto them. They're just laying here. But the thing is where they're going. So I had to, the first thing I did was to test it out. So I took thick wires random just across the board onto the other side, and the RAM slots instantly started to work. But what I did now to make it more tidy and for it to look better, I'm going to show you right now. So this is our side view now. As you can see, I ran the wires, the enameled wires for our connection, through the bottom of the PCIe, the RAM bank. So there's a hole that I used where those two wires run through. I'm going to show you the backside now. This is the hole I used to run the wires through. So they are the least visible and the shortest. So you might now think, but you took a contact away. You unsoldered the contact. How you just made it worse by doing that. Actually, no. The good thing is, I found out that there are pins that have no connection. So if you count, this is on the first RAM bank, the first, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth contact. We go to our board view now. We see on our board view that the sixth contact that is the closest is this one, is a no connect pad. This pad has no connection. And I tested that there's no ground connection. So this pad is completely free. As you can see, these are the ways where our original wires went from these two pins. So I was able to unsolder this hole and pull the enameled wire through that. Was quite a hassle, took me quite some time to pull two wires through there, but it eventually did work out. If you're interested, the wire that I used is 0.1 enameled jumper wire. It's not very good wire, just the thickness was important, that is 0.1 millimeters. And that kind of wire I pulled through and then put onto our two contacts, which is one this one and one's this one. The good thing is this wire is connected to the other pin and this wire is connected to that pin. As you can see again in the board view, we're quickly going to change to that. You can see we find our two pins that were missing, like for example this one, and the two pads are connected between each other. Without me running wire to both of them, just to one of them was enough. I specifically checked that with my multimeter. And just like that, the other one did as well. The other one connects like that. That's why we only have two wires going there. And the third pin, as I told you before, we fixed by that solder pad that I showed you, which looked quite awful. So now we're at the point where we got both RAM slots working again. And now, if you put the tester in, as you saw before already, all the diodes are lighting up. All the diodes that are necessary, also these two that we have fixed, are both lighting up now. So we have a fixed mainboard right now. all from the help of this really cheap DDR4 tester. This tester is like, I think, less than 10 bucks, this tester, and it does the job what it does if once you figure out how it works. And now I'm going to show you that it's not a fluke. I'm going to build it all up. I'm going to show you the result that it is working with 4 RAM slots. So we are back at our quite messy test bench. Everything is hooked up. RAM is in there. CPU is in there. Got HDMI connected to our TV. We got our power supply hooked up. 270 milliamps draw, which is quite normal for this board. It has LEDs and whatnot. So standby powers are running. We are now going to use our power button here. And you're going to see the codes starting to run. As you can see, our power consumption went up. Codes are running. Board is trying to boot up. We just got a makeshift cooler on here, just so the CPU doesn't instantly fry. A2 means we're booting. And as you can see, okay, we got our BIOS. And as you can see in the top right, we got 20 gigs of installed RAM, 20,480 megabytes. We got 3 4 gig sticks and 1 8 gig stick for a total of 8 gigabytes. And like that, this beautiful mainboard is running now again. This is the power consumption of it. And yeah, hope you liked the repair. I had to get quite creative with the way I fixed this, the way I ran the wire. And it took me quite some time to find out which pad connect where, and the testing was not quite easy because you had two sides to test. But I'm happy for this beautiful board to work again, even though the fix doesn't look as great because I never could find the actual break. But I'm happy with it. Hope you guys enjoyed it, and I will see you in the next one. Bye.